we thank God for the anointing of the Spirit.
Yes, amen.
Amen. You know, Adam had everything except the Spirit, indwelling Spirit. He had everything except the Christ, the blood. He didn't have that. And so, praise God, God has given us something that even Adam, the man that was made perfect as God wanted him, did not have. And moreover, we saw the gospel coming from Paul, Peter, James, John, 12 apostles who were with Jesus, that the gospel has not deteriorated. It has increased. That is the coming of Christ into the temple. Is like the priest that came in first through the gate. Then he went through the door.
Yes.
Then he went through the veil.
Amen.
And so we know that Christ then is coming in his fullness in us. But I want you to notice carefully that the Bible said coming. Not has come. He's coming. And somebody said, boy, what a long journey. How is he taking so long? Well, let me tell you, the soul of a human being is a very, very tough thing. And only God can change it and make it to be in the image of God rather than in the image of Adam. You see, there are two images, the image of Adam and the image of God. And all the Bible is showing us is a progression, a progress being made, not because we are better people, but because God has ordained. You will notice he said, in the fullness of time, so and so happened. In the fullness of time, Jesus came. We have the humanity must go through the three feasts. Three feasts. The first feast, Passover, where the blood is shed. You receive the blood, the quickening of the blood. The blood will take you to the next feast. The next feast is where the Spirit comes into the temple. And you must understand that the Spirit of God is God. Yes.
Amen.
The blood of Jesus Christ is the life of Jesus coming into you.
Amen.
But the personality of God does not come into you until you receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
That is what makes it so important that in all we are doing, we should strive to get the infilling of the Spirit. For when the Holy Ghost comes into you, he begins to teach you about Christ. Imagine that. Now remember, there are some teachers who teach that when you accept Jesus, that you get Christ in you. You don't get Christ. You get the blood of Christ. You get his life. And that life leads you to the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
It is Christ that baptizes you in the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost baptizes you into Christ. Can we understand that?
Yes.
So therefore, the baptism of the Holy Ghost is a divine work of Jesus Christ himself. If you want the Holy Ghost, you pray and ask Christ to give you the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Because the Holy Ghost comes as God incarnate. God living within man. And when God lives within man, God begins to transform the man to be like God.
Amen.
Some people say it is impossible that we can become like God. If it is impossible, why would God tell us that we should become like God? If you turn with me to Matthew, I know it's verse 28. I don't remember the chapter. Eh? It says, "Be ye perfect." I think it's chapter 7, you know. 5? Oh, it's right before me here. "Be ye perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect." I don't know if you realize why he said that. He could say, "Be ye perfect," and leave it at that. It would be so ambiguous that we would miss it. Because the word perfect has several different meanings. It means complete and things like that. But God made it clear. He said, "Be ye perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect." Now, that leaves no space for conjecture, no space for argument. We know that God is perfect. And we say to ourselves, but we cannot be like God. You know, we feel so low down. As a matter of fact, he said he made us lower than the angels, but crown us with glory and honor, so that you will judge angels.
Amen.
Can you understand that? God, in his divine wisdom, made man a low down creature, an earthbound creature. A creature that eats grass. A creature that gets his energy from the earth. Hallelujah. Then he put in a little thing there for you. You get your energy from the earth, and all of a sudden you believe, well, Mother Earth. Mother Earth, this is my calling. And then God says, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." Now we understand something peculiar from that the words from God has energy, has life in it, has quickening power. It has quickening power, it has life, it has energy to lift you out of whatever condition you are in, because God said so. It is so.
Amen.
Now, so therefore, it is absolutely necessary for us to have the Word of God. Because, you know, a lot of people say God said this and God said that. But anything God says is the Word of God. And anything time you get the Word of God, it quickens you. Amen. It quickens you. The dead hear the word of God and he lives.
Amen.
Amen. He said the day comes when those that are in the grave shall hear the voice of the Son of God and they shall live.
Yes. Amen.
Don't you understand? The word of God, therefore, cannot be maybe this or maybe that. It's going to have to be that. You know, many people say that I am too dogmatic. But if you preach the word of God, you can't be anything less than dogmatic.
Amen.
There's no argument. After God says so and so, there's no argument. If it's not God now, okay, there's space for argument. If I have to go and study the message to tell you today and put it together and have my homiletics in order, then it means that I am the one that is giving you the word. It's not a message. Now, a message comes from God. And very often, the messenger does not know what is in the message. You know, we have many mailmen here. How would you like a mailman who had to go home and open all the letters and read all the mail before he gives it out? A mailman's duty is to deliver mail. His duty is not to read mail. Anytime he begins to read mail, then he's committing a crime. So it is, the messenger of God. If a man then is going to bring the message of God, he must bring a pure, unadulterated word, thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
You know, I was afraid to preach, and I said to God, I am afraid to preach because I don't want to be saying something that God didn't say. And what God told me, he said, you go and I will be with you and I will tell you what to say. Now this is what I am saying to you. Do you believe I preconceived it? Never thought of it. Never thought of it. Now, I'm not condemning any other preacher. I'm just telling you that the gift of God works this way with me.
Amen.
That I speak to you without preconceived thoughts. I relax myself. Ask Jesus Christ to forgive me of all my sins. Oh, yes. While some of you are singing, I'm there asking God to forgive my sins.
Amen.
That there be no fault found in me.
Yes.
That's what happens to me.
Yes.
When I sing all these songs, I worship you, Lord, it just floors me. I find out that I'm nothing at all before God.
Amen.
Yes. So, because of this, I'm able to give you an unadulterated word, and I pray God that it might be unadulterated.
Amen.
Amen. Now, the thoughts that are coming to me, I just want to share them with you. Amen. The thought that has been strong on my heart for the past maybe a year or 6 months, it's the thoughts of the birth of the body of Christ. That we are the vessels through which God wants to express himself.
Amen.
This is 2003, the end of this year. Couple of days time, we are in 2004. And God ordained that in the year 2004, that men would begin to preach the gospel of the kingdom more than they preached it in 2003.
Amen.
Or 2002. That means to say that there is a progression. Something is growing. Something is coming to fruition. God is bringing the church
Amen.
To a place where he and the church can be one.
Amen.
I do not know why it should be so hard. Every one of you who loves someone, who has been married, or you maybe just love someone, the yearning in your heart is to be one with that person.
Amen.
Yes, the yearning in your heart, and that yearning never leaves you. As a matter of fact, it grows upon you.
Amen.
Oh yes, as the years go by, the 50 years go by, you are 50 years ahead of the other man who just got married.
Amen.
Because you have that desire to be one with this person, to walk with the person, and to be part of the person, so that sometimes even your thoughts become one. Amen. You didn't have to say so and so, because the other person knows exactly what the Spirit is moving on them, and you find that it's the same the Spirit is moving on you to bring you into that perfect union before God.
Amen.
Now, we are talking then about a plan that has reached to its final stage. And I don't know if it was Russ that said yesterday something about we have to die. No, it was Mark. We have to die. I mean, he didn't carry out the thought. And you know, you could have left it there and make some mistakes. But the death of the hindrance, what is hindering you from being one with Jesus Christ? The death of that thing releases you to be one. There's only one thing that God has organized that you die without dying physically. And we call the message death to self.
Amen.
So that the picture before us is the picture of Samson. Oh yes, the picture of Samson. Let us read what Jesus Christ said in Matthew chapter 16. Thank you, buddy. In Matthew 16, we find a little discourse here between Jesus and his disciples. Verse 13, when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I am? I, the Son of Man, am. That's peculiar. Who do you say that I, the Son of Man, am? In actually, he told them who he was. Well, you know, I always find such fun in my scriptures. You know, somebody come and said, who do you say that I, Cecil duCille, am? You know. Well, he said, and they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. He said unto them, but whom say you that I am? I cannot help but believe that every time Jesus said the word I am, it had a force, a power. When he was in the garden and Judas came and kissed him, the priests, one of the men, came up and asked him, are you Jesus Christ, Yeshua? They didn't say Christ. Are you Joshua, Yeshua? He said, I am he. And everybody fell backwards. And you know, I think he called the Hebrew word, he said, Haya, Haya.
Amen.
And when he said, I am that I am, boom, everybody fell backward. And he called them and said, come, I told you, I am he, you know. And the further proof of it, Brother Peter, with his hot temper, he pulled out his sword and he went for the neck, the jugular vein. off of this high priest's servant. And the man shifted his head and he took off his ear. You don't think a man go chopping off people's ears, do you? He went for the neck. And it was a plan of God to manifest the power of Jesus. If that man did that to me, I resign immediately. I am not taking him.
Yeah, amen.
Huh? The man picked up the man's ear and put it on back.
Yes, amen.
Huh? His ear is as perfect as it was before. I'm gone. No, sir. I wouldn't be fooling around with a man like that. Put on my ear. Oh, God bless you, brethren. Amen. Said, who do you say that I am? No, I am. It's a question to us.
Amen.
Yeah.
And the answer will be, if I am, if he is God, then serve him as God. He said, all right. They were dumbfounded. Because you see, some of them weren't sure. Some of them weren't sure. Remember, they were saying he was a magician. They were saying that he was the prince of devils. Because he did all these miracles. And these brethren were dumbfounded. But Peter got utterance, anointing. You hear me? Peter got an anointing. And he said, Simon Peter answered and said, thou art I'm just thinking of what he said in Hebrew. You know? He said, thou art HaMashiach.
Yes,
thou art the Christ, Bar Yahweh.
Amen.
Hmm?
Son of Yahweh.
And he said, nobody could say that except God had told him to say so. And I said unto thee, Peter, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Okay, you saw me. You said I am the Messiah. Hmm. And let me tell you, brethren, when you tell a Jew the word Messiah, he doesn't have that foggy understanding that we have when we say Christ. To him, Messiah is God incarnate. God incarnate. Spirit, soul, and body, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost living in one human being. Thou art God incarnate. Hallelujah. He said, well, all right. I'm going to tell you who you are. You are Peter. You are a little stone.
Yes.
But on this rock, huh? On this rock of your confession,
amen,
I am going to build my church.
Amen.
And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The more they kill Christians, the more Christians increase. Huh?
Amen.
The more they persecute Christians, the more Christians increase.
Amen.
God says that we are born of God.
Amen.
Not of corruptible things. We are birthed from on high by the power of Almighty God. And the quickening of the Spirit of God must be in us. Now, you see my chart, spirit, soul, and body. Oh, you can see it, can't you? Three circles. I noticed Watchman Nee draw spirit, soul, and body. He put one outside circle as body, one inside circle as soul, and one inside that as the spirit. I was about to draw it like that. God said, no. Draw it as three different entities. Amen. With three different they're destiny. Destiny. They have three different destinies. My spirit, his destiny is to go back to God regardless of what I do.
Amen.
My soul is to be married to my spirit. And when they're married, he's going to take it back to heaven.
Hallelujah.
My body is destined for the earth. But because I love my body so much, God's going to let me come back and pick it up. Amen. And a man, Job, said, though worms eat my flesh, yet in the same flesh, I'm going to take it back from all the families of the worms. Huh? Worms going to suffer great loss. Huh? Can you imagine the day when God said, give me back. Give me back, John. Give me back, Tom. And the worms have to give up. Because God says every substance will come back together in the resurrection. Now, of course, a natural man cannot understand that. Hey, they haven't even known how to take out milk out of coffee. Somebody said the guy was such a thief that he could take milk out of a coffee. But the scientists can't even take milk out of coffee. Then they think of an atom bomb falling on a Christian and blowing him into gas. Gasify him. And he's gone. And God called. And the voice of God, the trump of God, and the voice of the archangel, call, John, come forth. Hey! Shulamamakia. All the elements of earth give way. Let loose, John. And the man comes back here. You know, in my tussle with the devil, sometimes I tell him, I said, you're a fool. You're a fool because no matter what you do to me, no matter what you do to my brethren and my friends, no matter what you do, they are going to come right back here in the same form and just really mock you.
Amen.
Yes, we need to believe the word of God.
Amen.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. God's word never dies, never fades.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Loose. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. And if you will look with what God is doing at this time, it's a marvelous time to be alive.
Amen.
It's a wonderful time to be alive. I thought when I got saved down there, and maybe 60 odd years ago, that, so long, brother. Amen. That Jesus was going to come right away. So I felt that I would be in the, you know, a young man in the resurrection time when I would meet Jesus. I felt I'd never die. I would meet Jesus at the same time. I had a lot of people who believed that they were never going to die, and I saw them die. But no, I am 81 years of age. September gone. And I am excited. I'm excited over what God is doing. That God is bringing this nation, this people, this holy nation, this royal priesthood of poor people. Yeah. Not the mighty, not the powerful. Amen. Poor, wretched people. People who can hardly stand up. Yeah. Hallelujah. He's bringing you into a place where he's going to form you into a mighty army. And this army will overthrow Satan.
Amen.
You see all the problems the devil's giving you? You use the weapons of God right now and get rid of those problems. There's nothing more important to you now than keeping yourself clean and sanctified before God. Some of us have ancestral spirits. And the ancestral spirits bother you. They bother you. Oh, they make you drink, they make you cheat, they make you lie. But you have the Spirit of God, and the Spirit of God will destroy every other kingdom that reigns in your members.
Amen.
You must believe that. You see, believe that and it will come to pass.
Amen.
Amen. Don't hang your head and say, poor me, I'm no good.
Right.
Don't hang your head, because God came to save sinners.
Amen.
Oh yes. The brother say, God came to save sinners of whom I am chief.
Yeah.
Do you know why he said he was chief? He used to murder Christians. He used to kill them anywhere he caught them. Amen. So God is saying to us now that be ye like your Father which is in heaven. You have to believe it. You have to believe it. You don't see it. You can't understand it. It doesn't look possible, but you believe it. You follow what I'm saying? Believe it, because it is the word of God. And then you lose the fear of death. Don't be afraid of dying.
Amen.
If somebody faces you with a gun to shoot you, you said, I'm not afraid to die. What about you? Generally, it's a coward that's standing before you with a gun. What about you? If you die now, you go to hell. If you shoot me and I die, I am with the Father.
Amen.
Moreover, you can't shoot me if the Father doesn't allow you to.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
You have to have that in your soul.
Amen.
You have to have the Word of God planted within the inmost parts of your being.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That whatever happens, you are going to believe God. Amen. A man thrown down with disease, 3 years lying in ashes. They didn't have lovely hospital beds for Job to lie down in. He was lying in ashes, and you know, they would use a gourd to scrape off all the corruption that his body was producing. And the man is in total torment. I don't know if you ever had a cut and got ashes in it. Huh? Potash. It burns. And he was lying down there for 3 years. And he said, I know. I know that my Redeemer lives.
Amen.
Huh? Can you understand that kind of a faith? Let the Word of God be planted in your hearts. Amen. And he said here, the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom. of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Now, I want you to understand exactly what Jesus Christ did. He said, I am giving you a key. A key that you will be able to loose those that are bound on earth and to bind some. And when you do that, heaven acts upon your behalf.
Amen.
If you don't do anything, what would heaven do? Nothing. You have the power to loose and to bind. I've had terrible experiences. I've had terrible experiences with this loosing and binding. And some of the brethren says, you talk about these experiences too much, but I'm going to tell you about it. I'm going to tell you till you believe it. Amen. This old ancient demon, coming up out of the sea. Every year it comes in and terrorizing the house. If you will come with me to Jamaica, I can show you the house. It is at Little Bay in Port Maria. A large house on top of a hill. And the Little Bay is out there. And this was a pirate spirit. One of those who used to roam the seas and kill. You know, I do believe that men become demons. You know that. Oh yes, men die, they become demons. They live, some live as demons and they die as demons. Hallelujah. This spirit came up into that house every year and terrorized the whole house. This house had about 10 or 15 bedrooms upstairs. I lived in the loft up at the top of the house, little room. I loved it so much. Nobody comes around my room. Nobody bothers me. I'm away up the top. Suddenly I wake up in my sleep and here comes somebody through the front door. The door makes a big noise coming through. And he begins to walk up the step. And he walks, boom, boom. Peg leg, you know, he has a wooden foot. I don't know what you call it here, peg leg. And he comes, boom, up the stairs. And everybody's terrified. And I get madder and madder. How dare this thing to come into this place? And I went behind the door and waited for him. Had the latch open, and as he come to my door, he knocked, pam, pam. I don't know why they knocked three times, but I never allow him to knock the third time. I jumped right out on him. And I cursed him. You know that he never came back.
Amen.
To this day, that spirit was discharged and sent to hell. He never came back. You have power. Hey! Amen, God. Over the spirits of darkness. Why are you afraid of them?
Amen.
Those things are afraid of us.
Amen.
Did you know that?
Amen.
I want you to know that demons are afraid of you. Especially if you walk in the light as he is in the light. If you walk in the Spirit of God in love, in the power of God in you, no spirit on earth can touch you.
Amen.
You go to the hospital, And most of the people who are sick in the hospital beds, they are taken by spirits. Yeah. Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Most of the people in the hospital beds, they are there because spirits make them sick. It's so very, very easy when you discern the condition. We were in church one Sunday night. A woman brought in a little girl on crutches. This foot had a sore in it. It went right through the ankle, deep and black all over, and it could not be healed. Now, when you are going to rebuke a spirit and you have a lot of unbelievers around you and you're not sure of yourself, you just get down and whisper to the spirit. I put my hand over the stinking sore. I put my mouth on my hand. I said, get out of there in the name of Jesus. Get out.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The child's foot went down. She walked out of that place. And by the next week, it was totally healed. She was gone to school.
Amen.
Amen.
What is wrong with us? Why don't we understand that God says to you, I give you power over the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you.
Amen. Hallelujah.
You understand? There must be an understanding that you believe the word of God. There's a movement going on to disfigure the word of God.
Yes.
Oh, God didn't mean this. He meant that.
Right.
You see, he didn't mean that. He meant that. And it is designed to destroy your power.
Amen.
Believe in the Lord God, and nothing shall by any means hurt you.
Amen.
Yes. Nothing shall by any means hurt you. And he said, anytime you lose something on earth, pow, heaven answers. Tell me, brother, what was it that made the demon leave the child's foot? Huh? The name of Jesus, that's a short way of saying it. Yes, it was that God wanted to lose the child.
Amen.
God wanted to lose the child.
Amen.
And God put it in the mother's heart to bring her and to ask for prayer. And when she asked for prayer, God put it into me to speak the words. Amen. I'm telling you, sometimes I feel like just an actor. You know how actors go on, they act a part. They know it's not real, but they're acting as John Brown, and they act John Brown. And I feel sometimes like an actor. One Sunday morning, we are in this little place having church, and a woman brought in a boy. And she said, Brother duCille, I've heard that you receive power. I just got baptized in the Holy Ghost. I've heard that you receive power. I want you to heal this boy. I felt inadequate. I felt like an idiot. You know how an idiot feels?
Yeah.
I felt inadequate. I was embarrassed. Brother duCille, I want you to heal this child. I was embarrassed because I knew that I had no power to heal this child. And I remember when I used to talk with Jesus in the afternoon in my young Christian training, that he said, when he left me that last afternoon, he said, anytime you want me, you call me. I will be there. And so I felt that I need him now. And I just said to myself, oh God, what am I going to do? Here she comes before everybody. Jam this child in my face. Heal him. And I know I can't. I said, God, what am I going to do? And a voice spoke right in my ear. He said, you are not going to do anything.
Amen.
And then he added, I am. When I heard that, I got brave. Amen. Just an actor. If you know what God is going to do, you could do anything. You could say abracadabra. You could, you know, you could do anything. So I went up. I didn't even know what to pray. Put my hand on the boy and said, in the name of Jesus, be healed. You know, and then of course nothing happened. But he said he was going to do it. So I stepped back and I said to the boy, Clifton, I want you to talk. Clifton remained silent. I said, the Lord came to me, said, tell him what to say. I said, Clifton, say Jesus. Clifton was standing like this. He turned around very slowly. He looked at me and he said, Jesus.
Amen.
And I'm telling you, electric. People screamed and ran. And it was confusion for a while. And then the mother said, wait, let's say something. She said, this boy was born without a tongue in his mouth. I went to the doctor, and the doctor says that they could try to make some incision, but he's too old. He's 16 years of age, and he cannot. Medical science can do nothing for him. And so she said, now he talks. I want to see his mouth. And so I wasn't wonderfully full of faith, as somebody taught. I said, oh Lord, you know, probably the thing tear in his mouth and his mouth is full of blood, you know. But the devil can bring some carnal thoughts to you, even in the midst of your doing it. And I'm standing there waiting to see the result. She opened his mouth. The boy has a normal, beautiful tongue in his mouth. God put the tongue in his mouth. The word of God. You hear me? The word of God. The word of God in your heart can do anything.
Amen.
You need to believe God, that the word of God will abide in your heart, will stay in your heart, will remain in your heart. Don't let any other word come in. Anything that is contrary is antichrist. Amen. It was so sad to see. I was looking at the television the other night, and I saw this beautiful man, a black man, who is the pastor of a church in Washington, I think. And he was explaining his position and his whole life. And he said he was Pentecostal. And that why he broke with the Pentecostal is because everybody else talked in tongues and he couldn't talk in tongues. So they refused to have him as their pastor. So he went to the college and got his degrees, his doctorate and everything. And then now they gave him this wonderful church in Washington. And he is giving his, and he said that they have just certified same-sex marriage in his church. And the reporter asked him, but why? It is contrary to your Pentecostal training. It's contrary to the Word of God. Why have you done that? And let me tell you, he was so smooth. He rationalized everything. They are human beings just as we are. And they need our love. And they need, okay, and if they are of different sexual orientation, then we should accept them. Listen, brethren, hear me. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
God loved the world. Oh, we love them. We don't hate homosexuals. But we hate homosexuality.
Amen.
God said no sodomite should come into his place. You hear me? No sodomite. They destroyed all the sodomites out of the temple. Amen. A man should consider the Word of God, regardless of your education. Because it seems that education turns some people upside down. It's better for them if they never had any education. If you have education and it's going to send you to hell, it's better you never were educated.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
But some of us are swapping education for our children's life, spiritual life. Every boy I know that I sent to college has been destroyed by college. And only God can save them over, can deliver them. If somebody here has a child that you sent to college and he still remains hot for God, let me know about it. He's an exceptional person.
Amen.
I want to know you. I want you to come and tell me about yourself, because I want to know you. I want to see you on the mission field right away. Amen. You are an exceptional person before God if you're still hot for God after you leave college. Amen. So there is not a rule of thumb that I'm giving you that you must be no good. But I am telling you, I've had problems after problem with everyone that I sent to the secular college. Amen. We come back to the binding and the loosing. God wants you to be able to believe the Word of God so much that you put your life down on it. Yes. Believe the Word of God that you put your life down on it, so that you can bind evil forces and loose men by speaking the Word of God. And the Word of God must dwell within you so that you can speak it. Now, let's go back up a little notch. It says here, the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. But isn't that contrary to some of the things we are seeing around us? It seems to me that hell has taken some of our brethren as a football. It seems that the gates of hell have had them bondaged in prison. Let us read the little story about Samson. If you turn with me to the 16th chapter of Judges. We want to read something about a man who was in the gates of hell, who seemed to have been bound,
yes,
hallelujah, by fornication. And his nature, of course, wasn't yet changed. And therefore, he could not do better. Judges 16. It says here, then went Samson to Gaza and saw there an harlot and went in unto her. Now I want you to understand what happened to Samson. Samson was a type of the church, the true church of God. The harlot is a type of the harlot church.
Yeah.
Now, what do I mean by a harlot church? A church is supposed to be the bride of Christ. Amen? A church that is supposed to be the bride of Christ and is playing with the world is a harlot church. So a worldly church is called a harlot church. It sounds very simple, doesn't it? We didn't know what a harlot church is. It's a church that is in the world and is off the world. Yes. A church that must have political correctness. A church that must have political correctness. That you must say what is right, that the world wants to hear. A church that cannot differentiate between the word of Muhammad and the word of God. A church that cannot differentiate between Muhammad as a prophet and Jesus Christ as the Son of God. Because the Quran says Jesus Christ is not the Son of God. The Quran says Jesus Christ is a prophet. Amen? So therefore, the Quran, you have to be able to look at it and say, this is not God's book. Not the same God that we worship that writes the Quran. But you see, if you are afraid to say that, then you'll have a lot of friends in Washington and elsewhere.
Yeah.
Bless God for Franklin Graham.
Amen.
Franklin Graham didn't,
amen,
I mean, mince words with them.
Amen.
And his sister too. So Billy Graham had two children that were bolder than he.
Amen.
I believe more in the word of God than he does. Because they never compromise.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So when you pray sometimes, you know, pray and ask God to help Franklin Graham.
Amen.
To come into the word of the kingdom.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. He said this gospel of the kingdom, it's not just any gospel, you know. You understand?
Amen.
There's a gospel of salvation. And you call men to be saved. and you don't introduce the kingdom to them. There's a gospel of the grace of God. How good God is. Oh, God is so good. He wouldn't let you go to hell. He's so nice. It's a good God. But you have the gospel of the grace of God, but you have, Jesus said, this gospel
Amen.
Of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world before the end come. So, as far as I know, this gospel of the kingdom is not preached in all the world. I was in India, and it was like 3 o'clock in the morning. They start to, the Muslims start with their Allah, Allah, Akbar, Allah, and they make a loud noise. They have a loudspeaker that goes over the whole town and tall towers, and they cry Allah Akbar. And this man cried out Allah Akbar, and it hurt me so badly. And I said, oh God, what am I doing here? And God came down in person and said, this gospel of the kingdom must be preached in India also.
Amen. Amen.
It shook the whole room we were in. Three of us were in there, Brother Gordon and Brother Godwin and myself. This gospel of the kingdom must be preached here in India also. Believe me, brethren, you have something precious.
Yeah. Amen.
You need to start sharing it.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
But how can they hear without a preacher?
Amen.
And how can you preach unless you are sent?
Yes.
And how can you be sent unless you are prepared?
Amen.
Because God Almighty must prepare a ministry before you can go out there and challenge demons. Let me tell you what I've known. I've been like 50 years with these men working, with A.A. Allen, with all of these men, or Roberts and all those, and I have seen what has happened to them. Every man that is a one-man power has been cut down. Do you know why? Because God has a body, and the body is the strength, huh? The strength of the whole church, the body of Christ. And if a man is a one-man power, then the body is obeying him.
Yeah.
And if the body is obeying him, he has no strength. When the devil comes, he's going to mow him down. I knew a man. He was casting out the devil. And this devil was very stubborn. And you know, when a devil is stubborn, let me tell you the truth now about devils. When a devil is stubborn, you have a problem. You need to go home, fast, and pray. Don't cast out any devils until you are covered with the blood, full with the power of God. And when you speak, the boom, hit him. No devil can take that. It's a blast that tears him apart. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. The devil look at you. You know what he sees? He sees you in light or in darkness or in shaded. And he knows he can take a chance with you. You understand? And when you speak the word of God, there's a blaze of light. It disorganizes him. Do you understand what I'm talking about? It's like you tear limb from limb. A devil is disorganized and he's cast out. And if you cast him out into the abyss, angels of God, what you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Angels of God grab him and take him off.
Amen.
It's like you call the police to arrest him. So you understand what I'm talking about?
Amen.
And so I was telling you a story, right?
Yeah.
What was I saying?
About a man that didn't have the power and it was
that's right. Yes, this man, they tried to cast out this devil out of the sister, and they couldn't. They tried, they couldn't. And he tell the devil to come into him. Yeah. And the devil took him, and the sister was loosed. You know what happened next? He said he is Christ. He got an antichrist devil. And we had many battles because this brother who I was working along with, all of a sudden say he is Christ. A sister who came from Watchman Nee in China, she rushed up, held him by his feet, and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." I sit down right there. I said, and I said, "All right, poor child, she doesn't know better. He's going to correct her." And he gets up and he says that God said that if you do it unto the least of these, you do it unto me. So if she worship me, she worship God. It became a terror in the whole group. Remember now, this group had tens of thousands of people. We had been preaching to these people through and through the whole United States. Night and day, my wife and I never rested. Building churches, building groups. And all of a sudden, this thing smote us. Thou art the Christ. Just exactly as Peter said. Now, who revealed that to her? Was the devil, the Antichrist. And the man believed it. And that thing took him to his grave. Oh, yes. Took him to his grave. Okay, that's only one. But I tell you more than that. I don't know. Sometimes I feel guilty. When you lay hands, you remember Hebrews chapter 6?
Yeah.
Says that Paul says that the laying on of hand is one of the basic foundation doctrines.
Amen.
You remember that?
Yeah.
I don't need to read it.
Right.
Right? Okay. The basic foundation doctrine is the laying on of hands.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Where did it come from? God called Moses and he said, "Call the priests, Aaron, and let the people lay their hands on Aaron and confess their sins over Aaron. And Aaron will bear their sins. And let Aaron put his hand on the lamb. And the sin bearer, the lamb, kill him. And all the sins will be forgiven." That's the laying on of hands. So you do an impartation by the laying on of your hands. When you lay hands on a person, do you know what you are saying? You are saying, "I am taking your sin and your suffering upon myself. I am putting myself in your position. Jesus, help us." Huh? Then you appeal to Jesus, "Help us." That's why the laying on of hands, don't lay hands on anybody unless you know what you're doing. Yeah. Hallelujah. One day, we were going to minister to a woman that was really devil-possessed. And there was a boy, a young man with us, who said that, who believed in his heart, that all these brothers, they are doing all these wonderful works. I can do it too. I can do it too. So he ran through a shortcut through the bushes and got to the home, woman's home, before we got there. You know what happened? When we got there, he was crippled. This hand was like this. He lay hands on her, and whatever was in her smote him. And he became epileptic, and no matter how we prayed, he would never got better until he died. The young man must have been 20-something. Laying on of hands. He said the doctrine of the laying on of hands. You put yourself in a position, you are taking the person's destruction upon yourself. Unless the virtue of Jesus is in you, and it go the other way. It's just like electricity. Like electricity. The 710 volt, so many watts. You put a higher wattage anywhere, it comes right in, push out the lower watt. The higher watt takes over. Amen. And God made a natural world, you know. And he made a spiritual world. And there are certain laws that govern the natural world and certain laws that govern the spiritual world. And he said, the law of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. So there is a law of sin and death. If you walk in the law of sin and death, your only hope is the law of life. Because life, pulsating, powerful life in Christ Jesus will drive out death anytime.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It all starts with your belief. If you believe God, you will overcome anything, all things. Nothing on earth can overcome you. You believe God. You go to God and say, Lord, why is it I am suffering so? I'm a loser. And you said I should be a winner. What is it, Lord God? Lord God said, whatever you put your hand to will prosper. Whatever. Don't you understand? Amen.
Amen.
You go out there and you start making marbles. You prosper. Because God said, whatsoever you put your hand to, you'll prosper. You have no bad intentions. You want to make a living. God is with you. But that's not the end of the story. The greatest thing that you can be is to take up your calling in God. And be serious about your calling, like how you were serious about your studying in school, being a student, becoming, getting your BA and doing this and doing that and doing the other. God Almighty is saying to you, now is the time. Now is the time to turn all your efforts to God, because everything else will pass away, but my word shall not pass away. Yes. And so we see Samson. Am I too long? Say a good no and I'll continue. Amen. If I'm not interesting, then yes, this man went down to Gaza to a harlot. And he was told that the Gazites saying, Samson is come hither. And they compassed him in and laid wait for him all night in the gate of the city, and were quiet all night, saying in the morning, when it is day, we shall kill him. Remember now, this man was in the harlot house. Samson is a type of the true church of God. We have been in the harlot house. We have been mixing our gospel with worldliness. We have become Babylonish in our operations, because the gospel of Jesus Christ, holiness, should not be mixed with unholiness.
Amen.
As I said yesterday, washing cars is not unholiness. So if somebody said, because you wash cars for the kids to raise money to go to Czechoslovakia, you are Babylon. That person doesn't understand the word of God. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I would not sin against God. Thy word. Amen. So therefore you must understand that though people might think that certain actions are Babylonish, if it is being led of God, if God is telling you what to do, giving you grace and power to do it, do it. Amen. Don't care what man says. Now, Samson is a type of the church, and he's caught in a trap. He has a gate that can stop an army. Mighty, terrible gate. High, strong iron that is made to stop a whole army. And he's encased in, they lock the gate. And the men have surrounded the harlot house. And he is in trouble. Now, they said, we will kill him when the morning comes. And you know, brethren, let me tell you, they can kill us before morning. But once it turned around 12 o'clock in the night, it turned into morning. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he'll raise us up. And the Bible said, and it was early in the morning. Yes. Hallelujah. And there was a trembling, a shaking in the graveyard.
Amen.
Amen. And the stone was rolled away.
Yes, amen.
And Jesus came forth. Don't attack us in the morning. We have been suffering all through the night. The church, we are all of us. Every bit one of us have been bound in Babylon. We have been tied up in that. Hallelujah. We have been doing business with the harlot. And God Almighty said, they said in the morning, we're going to kill him. They made a wrong choice. And Samson lay till midnight. You know, at midnight, God called to Moses, said, tell the children of Israel to stand with their loins girt about. Kill the lamb. Kill the lamb at midnight. Because the blood of the lamb must be put over the doorposts and the lintels, and no devil in hell will be able to go through that door.
Amen.
Tell me, brother. What do you think would happen if Satan himself tried to walk through one of those doors? Huh? The light of God would hit him and he would be totally disorganized. Oh, yes. Do you know why, if you resist the devil, he flees from you? Can anybody guess why, when you resist the devil, he flees from you? Cannot stand your rebuke. If the light of God blazes out of you and hit him, it disorganizes a great part of his organization. Everything would be turned upside down. And so Satan will not manifest himself. You know, I mean, this is a little side thought. We used to hear in one time, there was a lot of mysterious things going on in the skies. And we say people talk about UFOs. We even had a sister who, she was standing at her living room door and look out the backyard, and there was this terrible manifestation. Something was there. And she thought it was a UFO. You know, and it kind of changed her somehow. But we won't go into that. What I am saying is that, do you think if Satan could manifest in a body and go to Washington and say he's from another planet, you know, maybe have ears like this and all that sort of thing, amen, and go to another and come to Washington and say he's from another planet and all this wisdom and power, you realize he could take over the whole human race? Huh? Why doesn't he do it? Huh? Come on. Tell me why Satan doesn't do it. Let's say that a manifestation come in Washington. Lo and behold, an aircraft land. And all the legs mark the ground, which I've seen. And here steps out. Hey, I am from Venus. And everybody get frightened from Venus. Somebody decide to shoot him. And somebody fires a gun and nothing happens. I said, feel me. And you can feel him. Can you imagine what would happen to the world? The whole world would begin to worship this thing, because he would have such wisdom and such power and such inventive abilities. Eh? Huh? You know why he doesn't do it? He can't do it. If he does it, one of these little children, I hear them singing, come up and said, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus, and zap, Satan's kingdom at an end. Huh? You understand? A child would be able to zap him with the power of God. Amen. But if the church was not here, he could do all wonderful things. Therefore, he has to continue to hide and to do his thing. And he has to continue to work through men to do his thing. You understand? And so Samson got up at midnight and he got an anointing.
Yes, amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He got an anointing. You see, the Bible says that at midnight there was a cry made.
Amen.
What was the cry?
Watch.
Abba, behold, the bridegroom comes. At midnight. Therefore, Samson got an anointing at midnight. Moses got an anointing at midnight, and that anointing would destroy all the forces of the devil.
Amen.
And put Satan to flight. And he said, and Samson lay till midnight and arose at midnight. You must believe this, brethren.
Amen.
The man was in sin. Amen. God cannot work with sin. God cannot work with sin. But something must have happened between the harlot's house and the gate.
Huh?
Something happened between the harlot's house and the gate. And the man Samson got the anointing of God.
Amen.
God must have sent Michael with the blood.
Amen.
Amen. To touch him and to deliver him from the sin that was upon him.
Amen.
And he went to the gate and he grabbed the gate and he shook the gate, and the tons of concrete that held the gate down into a deep foundation broke loose, and I could see him backing off.
Amen.
Huh? Hauling it out of its roots.
Huh?
And then the Bible said he put it over his head 100 or more tons. Do we have any cranes that lift that kind of weight? Some of you engineers, do we have a crane that can lift 100 tons?
Yeah.
Yes.
What? Very big.
Very large crane. Mm-hmm. Anyhow, this man took the gate. And you know what happened? He walked with the gate for 40 miles. Huh? That's not human. That's not human. That's some kind of machine. But it's God. That means that your bone, your joints, your muscles have the capacity to do anything that God wants it to do. Oh yes, he walked up a hill, the Bible said, for 40 miles, went up on the hill and put down the gate. And you know, the dramatic language of the word of God, yeah. It said, and it is dear to this day. No man could take that gate down. They had no equipment that could handle it. What is it saying? I close now. What is that story saying? Jesus translated to Peter. He said, Peter, I will build my church upon this rock. Confess Jesus as Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Confess Jesus as your Savior. Confess Jesus. You know, sometimes you have a problem. Let me tell you, the devil comes and gives us all kind of problems. You have a problem. Just start calling to Jesus. Call him by his real name, Yeshua, 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 come and help me. You'll see what happens. Oh yes, oh yes. My sister and her husband were having a quarrel. You know people have quarrels all the while. Some people. And she got so grieved that she started to cry out, oh God, help me. I'm in the room. I couldn't take it anymore. I went down to her and said, kneel down. And as I touched her, she started to scream. And she accepted Jesus, filled with the Holy Ghost, right then and there.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. You know why? Because the devil that held my family, his power was broken.
Amen.
When I got saved.
Amen.
And they begin to get saved one after the other, Frank, and then my sister, and then her children. Hallelujah. It just started a generation of saved people.
Amen.
When you damage a devil, he can't go back to your family. You hear me, sir?
Yeah.
Amen. The law says that the priest put 6 names of the children of Israel on his right shoulder and the onyx stone, 6 on the left shoulder and the onyx stone, and he kneeled before God. And as he kneeled before God, God accepted that Israel has knelt before him. All the names of the families of Israel has knelt before him in one man. Who are you? Are you fighting for your family? Are you destroying the gates of hell for your people? This is what God is saying to us. We have the power. All things are bound on earth that we bind in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Yeshua. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you. And so Samson went on, and you know, poor fellow couldn't help himself. He was back there. He didn't go back to Gaza though. He went to what? Sorek? And there was a woman there named Delilah. And Delilah was more powerful than this other poor woman. They didn't even put her name. They just say a harlot. But Delilah's name was put in the Bible for a purpose. Because Delilah represents a system that tempts men, that tempts God people. Yes, I'm going to stop now. I'm coming down. Bear with me a little bit. Delilah represents a system of worship that is contrary to God. But it looks like God. No, you dare not go out the street and talk against them. They will arrest you. They will do you all kind of manner of things. Because they say you're talking about these holy people. Let me tell you something. There's nothing holy about these men who claim themselves to be holy. There's nothing holy about the reverend so-and-so. You know, when I was ordained as a minister by one church, I went to God and I said, God, no, I didn't go to God. I was so excited. I went to the printers and I printed up cards. Reverend Cecil G. DuCille. And I have my cards now ready to start, you know, advertising my newly found title. And God says to me, what is that? I said, well, you know, I am Reverend. Huh? God said, have you ever looked up in the book, the Bible, what reverend means? Huh? I said, thank you, Lord. So I rushed to my concordance. And lo and behold, I found reverend only one time in the Bible. And it is in Psalm, Psalm 111, verse 9. And it says, reverend and holy is his name. So I look for the word reverend in the Strong's. And you know what it is? Yahweh. Hallelujah. For me to go and call myself Yahweh as a title, men call me Yahweh. Oh, God, forgive me. And the ministers, they know it. They know it. I've spoken to many ministers about it. And they said, well, you know, it's just a title. It's just. But the Catholic Church did it.
Yeah.
And they have the right reverend. And they have the Holy Father. Right reverend.
Yeah.
Holy Father, names of blasphemy.
Amen.
Names of blasphemy. Never call even your dog a reverend. Don't do it. God will not be pleased with you. God says those, it not only those people who call themselves that, but those who call them that. I am not calling anybody reverend.
Amen.
You're a Mr. So-and-so. And I'm a Mr. So-and-so if you want to be Mr. In. And the good ones, I call them brother. Eh? The good ones. You know, when I call a man brother, and he's not my father's child, I must mean something high. He's in the spirit, a brother in the Lord. Hallelujah. Reverend? No. Amen. Father? No. Amen. Holy? No.
Amen.
We can talk about that later. But Samson, let me finish his story. He went to Delilah And Delilah was in touch with the higher ups. She was like a spy, a fifth columnist.
Yeah.
And she took money. She took money from the powers that be to destroy Samson. Now remember, I'm talking about the church now. There is a church that will destroy us. I went to Russia, and the Orthodox Church was totally against us. And the people of God have to flee from the Orthodox Church in Russia. But they have now got a law passed wherein nobody can preach unless they have a certificate from the Orthodox Church. And so, if you go to Russia and preach, you are against the law. Amen. But then, Samson got in with this woman. And you know the story. He finally got her to know his secret. Your secret. What is your secret? Your secret is your hair, your covering. The Bible said the covering of the woman is the man, and the covering of the man is Christ. So the covering of the woman is Christ.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Now, Samson had a covenant with God that he should not drink strong drinks, he should not fornicate, and things like that. He did all those, and God still remained with him. But he did the final thing. What is the final thing? Take off the covering, brethren. The covering is the anointing.
Yeah.
You hear me? The covering of God is your anointing. Believe in the anointing. Believe in the covering. Believe in God. When she took off, shaved his hair, took off his covering, he was without power. But guess what? He didn't know. When you are deceived, you don't know that you are deceived.
Yeah.
You see everybody else as being deceived, you are all right. The man lost his covering, he didn't know he lost his strength.
Amen.
She said, Samson, the Philistines are upon you. And Samson ran out as in former times, the Bible said.
Yeah.
And he shook himself, ready to destroy them. They grabbed him, and he was like an ordinary man.
Amen.
What's the first thing they did to him? Pluck out his eyes. When the harlot catches you, brother, the final point is that you cannot see anymore.
Yeah.
You lost your vision. The church, the present day church, has no vision. But God said, we're the vision, there's no vision, the people perish. The church has no vision, the church has lost its vision. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The vision of God is that we should be like Christ.
Amen.
The vision of God is that God is working in us that we should become like him.
Amen.
Amen. You lose that vision, you lose out. And so praise be to God. It resulted in one thing. There was only one way God could deliver that church. Samson Church.
Yeah.
The man-child church.
Oh yeah.
True death.
Amen.
Amen. True death. Death to self.
Hallelujah.
Death to self. When that self that is giving you trouble is put to death, God Almighty will come forth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God bless you in Jesus' name.